Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon to some of you, I should say. Good morning to others, and good evening to others, depending on where you are joining us from. Welcome to today's session. My name is Carlton McLellan, and I am a senior fellow at the Association of Black American Ambassadors. And we'll talk a bit more about what that is and means later. But I wanted to welcome you on behalf of all of us today to this session entitled Sitting at the Head of the Table, Black U.S. Ambassadors Speak. As we get into today's session, allow me to please introduce for our official welcome and introduction, allow me to introduce to you all Ambassador Sylvia Stanfield, who is the President of the Board of Black Professionals in International Affairs, or BPIA for the acronym, one of many acronyms you'll hear many of us using today. So allow me to turn it over to Ambassador Stanfield to welcome you all and to say a few words. Ambassador Stanfield.
Thank you, Dr. McLellan. Hello, everyone. I am Sylvia Stanfield and the President of Black Professionals in International Affairs, or BPIA. And it's with great pleasure that I welcome you to this Black History Month event. BPIA is hosting this event in cooperation with the Association of Black American Ambassadors, the Thursday Luncheon Group, and the Congressional Black Caucus Institute. I know that all of you are interested in hearing what our distinguished panel has to say, and I don't want to take any more of your time, but I do want to welcome each of you. Thank you, and consider BPIA now for what I'm sure you'll find is an informative and illuminating panel discussion and moderated by our senior fellow at ABAA. Dr. McLellan, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Stanfield. I hope I've successfully unmuted myself. I hope you all will also bear with me as I sort of switch between screens for myself with my my few notes and also trying to look at the chat box and to sort of help lead and moderate this session. So forgive me if I'm slow and fumbling around here or there in terms of movement. But again, thank you, Ambassador Stanfield, for that welcome. We are all super excited about today's session. As she mentioned, we have a group of three very distinguished guests here, and we'll get to some formal introductions of them here shortly. But just to repeat, my name again is Carlton McLellan. I am, among other things, I'm a career, what we call citizen diplomat in international education, exchanges, and affairs professional, as well as a researcher. I'm extremely excited to moderate today's discussion, and thanks to BPIA for putting this together and providing us all with this great opportunity and program. I come to you today, as we've mentioned, in my capacity as Senior Fellow at the Association of Diplomatic Studies, at the Association of Black American Ambassadors, ABAA, and as a researcher who has spent probably 15 or 16 years of my life researching and looking into the history and contributions of Black Americans who have been U.S. ambassador. So very excited to have this discussion with three such distinguished leaders today. And again, thank BPIA, ABAA, the Congressional Black Caucus Institute, and the Thursday Luncheon Group for hosting and co-hosting and sponsoring this event. Just so that you know, the order of today's event, I guess, really is just to sort of, I will moderate the session, I'll provide you with just a very brief sort of background and sort of the context of the history of Black Americans who have served as U.S. ambassador. I'll try to keep that as very brief, but just to give you some of that background and context. And then we'll dive into having a what should be a stimulating discussion with our three discussants, who I will again introduce here in more detail to you all shortly. Of course, we're here today to sort of as part of the celebration and commemoration, if you will, of Black History Month. Hopefully all of us here today will agree that Black history should be celebrated 365 days a year, but that should not stop us from taking advantage of this month each year to put even more emphasis on Black history and celebrating it as such. So as we do so here today, we're going to be talking about an issue near and dear to my heart, Black American participation in international affairs, broadly speaking, and more specifically in the diplomatic arena. To help us do this, we have engaged this high level of panel of Black American or American ambassadors who just happen to be Black Americans. And so we're very excited about that. Again, the title of the session, sitting at the head of the diplomatic table, Black American Ambassadors Speak. And let me just briefly then just welcome and introduce them by name. And then again later, shortly here, we'll go into a bit more about their bios and hear them speak. But please help me with a welcome of Ambassador Pamela Spratlin, Ambassador Reuben Brigety, and Ambassador Dereck Hogan, who Ambassador Hogan joins us from Chisinau, Moldova, where I think it's probably around 7 o'clock or so in the evening there. So we thank him for joining us on his evening. Again, I'll provide you with more background on each of them here very soon. Let me also pause before we get in give a special note of congratulations out to Ambassador Linda Thomas-Greenfield, who, as we all may know, was nominated by President Biden as the permanent representative of the U.S. to the United Nations with the rank of ambassador. And just 2 days ago, was finally confirmed by the U.S. Senate. I believe Ambassador Thomas-Greenfield was also officially sworn in yesterday, I believe, by Vice President Harris. And hopefully she's on her way to New York, if not there already, to take over U.S. leadership at the U.N. So just wanted to send a congrats to Ambassador Thomas-Greenfield and all the best on reviving U.S. leadership and respect in this important global forum as she takes over the helm there. And just as a small note, let me add that Ambassador Thomas-Greenfield will join a great list of Black Americans who have held this important role at the UN, including in the past Ambassador Andrew Young, Ambassador Ronald, Donovan Henry, Ambassador Edward Perkins, and most recently, Ambassador Susan Rice. Of course, there have been other Black American U.S. ambassadors who have led in other U.N. agencies, such as the U.S. mission in Geneva or the U.S. mission in Rome. But that Black ambassadorial leadership at the United Nations is probably best kept for another discussion that hopefully we can all have at another time. But on to today's events. Today's event, I should say, the conversation that we are about to have with these three distinguished American diplomats, diplomatic leaders, is one that I have myself virtually every day as I pour through documents, reports, speeches, and other materials about and or by Black Americans who have been U.S. ambassador as part of my research focused on this theme. I've joked with several of the ambassadors that I've spoken with through the course of my research, either formally or informally through interviews. I've joked with them that I'm very obsessive about digging into their lives, but in a good way. I'm very interested and hope to encourage others through my research and work, hope to encourage others to also take an interest in what I consider a very underrepresented, under-researched, and quite frankly, underappreciated area of leadership, particularly Black American leadership is concerned. And that's Black leadership in international affairs, again, broadly speaking. But I've turned my obsession, I think, Black American U.S. ambassadors into years of research. I'm very proud to have the ambassadors that we have here today here to speak with us. Having said that, again, my role today is to moderate the session with these ambassadors, three of them specifically. Two are career foreign service officers who chose diplomacy as their respective professions. And one is a non-career, what's called a non-career appointee, who after a distinguished career as an officer in the U.S. Navy, has gone on to an equally distinguished career in international policy and development, as well as a university educator and leader. All three of our ambassadors here today have shown their leadership skills and grit to the point where they were recognized and eventually nominated and appointed by a U.S. president as our country's ambassador abroad. And so that's very important for us to keep in mind when we're talking about how distinguished these three individuals are and how potent their careers have been in their respective areas. But first things first, allow me to give you a quick pop quiz about the history of Black American ambassadors. It's nothing too detailed or nothing too complicated, I promise. But we had a few questions we thought we would pose to you all and just see how everyone answered with regards to Black American ambassadors. Thank you, Sydney. Here is the list of questions, five short, simple questions, we hope. If you could just take a couple moments to just read through each of these questions, those of you who are able, and just tick the box of answers that you think is correct. I'll give you a few seconds and pause with just a little bit of radio silence, if you will, as we each answer these questions. Just a few more seconds, if you don't mind. All right, 10 more seconds. Okay, great. Thanks. And again, to our communications people out there, sorry about that bit of radio silence. I know it's not always the best, but Sydney, could you show the sort of results of the poll range? How everyone answered. Thank you. All right. So just going through this really quickly. The first question, what percentage of these appointments, the 3,500, it should be 3,500, I apologize, appointments have been Black in the history of U.S. diplomacy. The correct answer is 44.5%. So basically the first two are correct. Sorry about that, a little snafu in our percentages. But there have been 156 Black Americans to officially serve as U.S. ambassador since the title and rank of ambassador was started to be used in 1893. 156 of those, of 3,500 is what the number should say, and that is 4.5%. So that is the correct answer. On the second question, what percentage of Black American U.S. ambassadors have been women? Those who answered B, 35%, would have been correct. Of the 156 Black American U.S. ambassadors, 101 of them have been men and 55 women. So with my math, that's 35%. On to the next one, what percentage of Black American U.S. ambassadors have been foreign service officers, which is FSOs, versus non-career appointees, NCA? The answer there is C, 56% foreign service officers and 44% non-career appointees. In real numbers, that is 88 have been foreign service officers and 68 have been non-career appointees. On to the next one, in which non-sub-Saharan African region has the most Black Americans held the rank of ambassador? The answer there is, and it looks like it got the lowest percent, which is interesting. The answer there is D, Europe and Eurasia. That includes such countries as Albania, East Germany, Finland, Iceland, Luxembourg, Malta, Moldova, Montenegro, Norway, Romania, Slovenia, Spain, and Sweden. All have hosted Black American U.S. ambassadors. And then the final question, what Black American has held the most ambassadorial postings? And it looks like that the answer there is actually B, which also got the least amount of the percentage of the answers. Ambassador Terrence Todman. Ambassador Todman served as U.S. ambassador on six separate occasions, to Chad from 1969 to 72, to Guinea from 1982 to 1975, to Costa Rica from 75 to 77, to Spain from 78 to 83, and to Denmark from 1983 to 1989, and finally to Argentina from 1989 to 1993. So I'll look at those results again later, but we just wanted to just quickly share a little bit of that with you and see how you all answered. So we appreciate that in joining us in that little bit of Black American U.S. Ambassador trivia. The final thing I'd like to do before we introduce our speakers formally and get into our dialogue with them, the final thing I think is important to do is just to give you a very quick summary, if you will, of the history of Black American ambassadors, and I promise it'd be very brief. But as I've sort of mentioned already, since the first such appointment was made in 1893, when President Grover Cleaver appointed Thomas F. Bayard as U.S. ambassador to Great Britain, there have been approximately 3,500 individual Americans who have held that title and rank. Of those, only 156 have been Black Americans. So I'm gonna repeat that. Of that, only 156 have been Black Americans. This means that historically only 4.5% of America's ambassadors have been Black. With the first being appointed in 1949 when Ambassador Edward Dudley became U.S. Ambassador to Liberia. Since then, every U.S. president has appointed a Black American as U.S. Ambassador at least one time. As one might expect, the early numbers were low, including President Truman's first appointment of Edward Dudley, followed by his immediate predecessors, President Eisenhower, Kennedy, and Johnson, appointing 3, 3, and 9 Black Americans respectively. I'm sorry, Black Americans, U.S. ambassadorship respectively. In the mid-1960s to early 1990s, these presidential appointments started entering into the teens, with 18 such appointments by President Ronald Reagan topping the list during that period. Then in the early to mid 1990s, a commendable upward trend of Black American U.S. ambassadorial appointments began as President Bill Clinton, President George W. Bush, and President Barack Obama all appointed 40 or more during their tenures. Unfortunately, this upward trend took a smashing dive during the most recent administration, with President Trump only appointing 5 Black Americans to represent the U.S. as ambassador. And fortunately for us, we're lucky to have one of those here today. Look forward to hearing from him as well. There's much more we could talk about regarding this history, and particularly the contributions of Black American U.S. ambassadors as American leaders. But I think it's time we move on to hearing from our group of distinguished guests today. that background in mind, let's turn now to formally introducing each of them one by one. You have their bios or have seen their bios in the program announcements, I believe, so I won't read bios in full, but let me just introduce each one of them first and just give you a quick summary of their background. Starting with Ambassador Pamela Spratlin. Ambassador Spratlin is a diplomat, speaker, and leader who spent nearly 30 years in the Foreign Service of the United States Department, U.S. Department of State. She retired in 2019 to work as a mentor, public speaker, and volunteer. She has served the U.S. as its ambassador to two different nations on two different occasions, first to Kyrgyzstan and later to Uzbekistan, as well as in numerous other senior government positions as a diplomat. Equally important, just on a personal note, Ambassador Spratlin is also a fellow Ohioan. She was born in Ohio, like myself. Second, we have Ambassador Reuben Brigety. Ambassador Brigety is the former representative of the U.S. to the African Union and permanent representative of the U.S. to the UN Economic Commission of Africa with the rank of ambassador. He is currently Vice-Chancellor and President at the University of the South in Sewanee, Tennessee, as well as an adjunct senior fellow for African peace and security issues at the Council on Foreign Relations. Ambassador Brigety previously served as Dean of the George Washington University's Elliott School of International Affairs and in senior government officials for the US government and other organizations as well. He is also retired, as I think I believe mentioned earlier, he's a retired US Naval officer. And in a recent speech I saw him give, he admitted to being a fan of the Netflix show, The Crown, of which I too am a fan. Finally, we have Ambassador Dereck Hogan. Ambassador Hogan is currently the US Ambassador to the Republic of Moldova and a career member of the US Senior Foreign Service. He has held numerous senior positions at the State Department headquarters in DC, as well as abroad in US missions. Ambassador Hogan also has the distinction of being the first Pickering Fellow to ultimately become a U.S. ambassador. I believe he was a member of the second cohort of the fellowship program back in 1993. I'm also happy to see that we share a common alma mater as the University of Pittsburgh, where I did my graduate studies, and I believe Ambassador Hogan did his undergraduate studies. At any rate, please join me again in officially welcoming our three ambassadors, Ambassador Pamela Spratlin, Ambassador Reuben Brigety, and Ambassador Dereck Hogan. What I will do now is turn to having a conversation with our three ambassadors, and we will do that. I will pose the first question, and to each of the ambassadors, it will be the same question to each one of them, if they don't mind. And once we have that brief conversation with them, I have my questions. As we do that, we invite you all to put your questions in the chat box, and we will do our best to get to as many of those questions as we can, as we say, and begin having the dialogue with these ambassadors. But beginning with Ambassador Spratlin, I will pose again this question to her first, but then I will also ask our other two distinguished panelists to address the same question. Here's question one, and again, this goes to you, Ambassador Spratlin, if I may. Given the context of the history of Black American U.S. ambassadors that I outlined a few moments ago, can you give us a few opening thoughts on how you view your role as a U.S. ambassador and diplomatic leader within this important yet overlooked area of Black American leadership?
Sure. First, just one technical point. I think I'm on twice because I'm sitting in a place that's very difficult to use Zoom. So I was eager to be sure that I was on this panel, but there may be a little bit of technical difficulty. I would like to say hello to you, Dr. McLellan, because you've done wonderful research highlighting what most people don't know very much about. And I think bringing that into the open is extremely important. So I'm very glad to be on this panel with my fellow panelists and also with you. I would say, the role of ambassador is an extremely important one. And it's funny, I happen to be in the State Department today, and there's an exhibit on the 21st Street side right now that talks about ambassadors and what is US diplomacy. And it's fascinating because there are several, many tens of thousands of people who work for the State Department, and most people don't know what we do. But the one position in the State Department and in US diplomacy that I think where people have some version or vision of what we do is the position of ambassador. And why is that? It's because it's the one position that is the face of the United States wherever it is that we serve. I think that we all should feel a sense of great pride in the fact that Ambassador Linda Thomas Greenfield was confirmed by the Senate by a vote of 78 to 20 a couple of days ago to be the face and the voice of the United States at the United Nations. Now, she isn't the first African-American woman to do that. Susan Rice had that same job between 2009 and 2013 in the Obama administration. But she is the first career member of the Senior Foreign Service who's a woman to hold that role. And so I think for all of us who are Foreign Service officers, for everyone who works for the State Department, it's an enormous honor and step for her to have that role. And I think already, just by virtue of the fact that she's been confirmed, we understand something that's important about the role of ambassador, the face and the voice of the United States representing the president and all of the people. And that, you know, is really saying something, particularly given the historical background that you just gave. There are thousands of people who've served as ambassador, and that's rare enough as it is. And there have been some men who've served as ambassador, African-American men, not very many, not nearly enough, but so few women. You said only 55. So Ambassador Thomas Greenfield joins a very, very small group. And I looked at your list of the 55 women. Of those, 16 have served as ambassador twice, and only 4 have served as ambassador 3 times or more. So it's an extremely rare opportunity for us to take this position. Now, the title of this is Sitting at the Table. And it's interesting when we think about the diplomatic table, because there are so many tables that you are representing the United States at when you are an ambassador. One is the country team, where you are sitting as the representative with all of the different federal agencies trying to execute US foreign policy. Another is when you're sitting in your residence, entertaining and, but I think not so much entertaining for entertaining sake, but you're entertaining for the sake of helping, of building a dialogue and helping people understand what it is that the United States is trying to accomplish and listening to what other people want to accomplish as well. We're at the table trying to decide what the program of the United States is going to be. At the table, talking to civil society, at the table, talking to business and academia. So you're doing all of that and you're doing it on behalf of the United States. And the very fact that it took so long, it wasn't until President Johnson named Patricia Roberts Harris to be the first African-American woman ambassador to Luxembourg in 1965, that African-American women could take this role and sit at the table. And so we've only had, you know, as of last year, 55 people, 55 years. So a very, very short time for us to have this role. For me, I was very honored to have this role in a part of the world that's a little bit more unusual for African-Americans. Aren't that many of us who serve in the Russian-speaking world? Dereck is one of them. And to be a person who helped open the aperture. My feeling is that we as African-Americans are the face of equality and justice in our country. And unless we are there, then our country is not even close to really reaching its fullest aspirations for itself, as stated in our Constitution and some of our other founding documents. So it's extremely important for us to be present in this. And I was very, very glad to open up a little space for the kinds of places where we could serve. We need to be everywhere. And I was very pleased to be able to be in the Kyrgyz Republic and to serve in the Republic of Uzbekistan. I wanna stop and give my co-panelists time to speak, but I will say that it was a tremendous honor. It's a very, very difficult role to attain. It requires leadership, and I'll be one who says I'm not opposed to political appointees, because why did we get Patricia Roberts Harris to be the ambassador? It was because of a president. She wasn't a foreign service officer. She didn't speak a language, and yet she was the absolute perfect representative at that moment and at that time. So we need sometimes to make that statement, and it's not always going to be the career service that will get us there. And so I think it's important for us both to have career officers and to have some political appointees who can bring a particular agenda that the foreign service might miss. But obviously it's a rare table to sit in if you are an African-American, and it was a huge honor for me. So with that, let me turn it back over to you. Thank you for the chance to speak and to go first.
Thank you. Thank you, Ambassador Spratlin. I would like to, I think there's a lot that she said that we'll be able to touch on as we move forward in the conversation. Several key sort of issues, items that she raised that I think would be fascinating to delve into a bit more as we go through this conversation or after. But let me now pose the same question to Ambassador Reuben Brigety, if I may. Ambassador Brigety, I'll repeat the question if that helps. Given the context of the history of Black American U.S. ambassadors that we sort of talked about before, can you give us a few opening thoughts on how you yourself view your role as a U.S. ambassador, as a diplomatic leader within this important yet overlooked area of Black American leadership?
Sure. Dr. McLellan, thank you so much. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, good morning, good afternoon, wherever the world may find you. It's an honor for me to be here with you today. Just a point of process, my name is pronounced Brigety. It's fine. My mother gets it wrong sometimes, so it's all good. No need to feel anything about that. You know, in diplomatic practice, we have the saying that everything has been said, but not everybody has said it. And given that the how eloquently Ambassador Spratlin, I think, addressed the bulk of your question, let me just sort of address a couple of things that may be unique, particularly to the those of us who are non-career ambassadors, and that I also think apply to career progression, generally speaking. First of all, I consider myself as a citizen, a steward of the Foreign Service. And what I mean by that is that I have enormous respect for the career Foreign Service. I have spent a lot of time encouraging members of the career Foreign Service, particularly those who are African-American members, particularly those who've been African-American members the last 4 years, to stay the course. I just had the high honor of testifying before the full House Foreign Affairs Committee yesterday under our Chairman Meeks, the first African-American to chair the House Foreign Affairs Committee, in which I spent a fair amount of my time calling for the rebuilding of the professional Foreign Service. And I also agree with Ambassador Spratlin that there is a role to play for those of us who have not dedicated our professional lives to the career Foreign Service, but still have some value to add. Now, given that, what I'm about to say is some real family advice to everybody here. You know, I've often say, I get asked this question a lot, as I'm sure many of the other ambassadors on the call do. So how do I get to there? How do I get to be an ambassador? And one of my pieces of advice, which is particularly relevant for African-Americans, is that the first test to whether or not you can be a good ambassador is whether or not you can get yourself appointed to be an ambassador. What do I mean by that? I mean that the level of political skill that it takes to navigate your way to be at the head of the table, as this this session is entitled, is the first display of the skills that you will need in order to effectively represent the country abroad. Now, what's interesting about that particular observation is that while they are similar, the skill sets that are necessary to navigate an appointment as a non-career ambassador are not the same as those that are necessary to navigate through the career professional Foreign Service, because as challenging as it is, because we know whatever the data is, only like 1 or 2% of FSOs at entry level will ever be Foreign Service officers, there are at least rules. There is a structure. However frustrating it may be, however long it may take, there is a way to do that. Whereas in the political realm, it is like a roller derby. It is much more free flow and much more challenging. But here's the thing that's true in both cases. It's a difficult truth, but I think it's true nonetheless. It has traditionally been harder for people of color to be able to amass the type of institutional or political capital that is necessary in order for when the time comes for your name to be on a list in somebody's room, for everybody else around that table to nod and say, yes, this, it makes sense for her to have this position, for her to represent the United States, for him to become a United States ambassador. Why is that? It is because, as a general proposition, networks tend to replicate themselves. And unless you are, two things have to be true. One, you have to be adept at being able to navigate the world of those who are sitting amongst the kingmakers, as it were. And there have to be enough people amongst the kingmakers who are prepared to advance the future of people who look like you. The good news is that over the last cumulative decade and a half, we've seen more and more evidence that that has become the case. The challenging news is that the empirical data, as Dr. McLellan just articulated, suggests that we are not yet at a point where the playing field is entirely level. And so that frankly requires us, not only those of us who are African-American foreign policy professionals, but also allies who believe in the full promise of America, to continue to push and to continue to insist that we have a broader diplomatic corps that is broadly representative of America, and to enlist allies for that effort. And crucially, as I think all of us are here today, for all of us to recognize that this is an intergenerational effort that requires us all to be part of an historical solution that is a work that will be going on long beyond our own professional lives. So thank you very much for the question. I look forward to further discussion.
Thank you, Ambassador Brigety. I hope I said that right that time. Apologies for that. I'm also one who don't have many pet peeves, but one is the misspelling using, not mispronunciation of my surname. So I'm very sensitive about that as well. So I apologize for that, and will do my best to get the pronunciation correct each time I say. And finally, last but not least, just in terms of this question, this first question, posed the same question to Ambassador Hogan. And as I do, and as Ambassador Hogan shares with us, again, encourage you all to start typing your questions, either for all three of our distinguished guests or for individual distinguished guests as we go along. I'm also gonna take a note, apologize if you should hear a train in the background in my hometown, Northwest Ohio currently. We have a lot of trains going through, so I apologize if you hear that train briefly. Sorry about that. Ambassador Hogan, again, given the context of the history of Black American U.S. ambassadors that we all kind of discussed now, can you give us some of your thoughts, your opening thoughts on how you view your role as a U.S. ambassador and diplomatic leader within this important yet under sort of looked at topic of Black American leadership? Ambassador Hogan.
Thank you, Dr. McClellan, and thank you for this opportunity to be among such distinguished panelists. Pamela Spratlin, she's someone I follow from afar. I don't think I've ever even had the chance to meet you personally, but I've known all about you, at least your professional career, since you are one of the ones who really broke the ground in terms of Eastern Europe being a place where people of color can make a difference. And so it is an honor to be on this panel with you. And, you know, Ambassador Brigety, you may not remember me, but I went into your office when you were a DAS in the AF Bureau, and you gave me a lot of really helpful advice in terms of my own professional development. So again, to be with you two is an honor for me. Also to listen to the presentation from Dr. McLellan, incredible. It is really, it's a proud moment, that we can celebrate that we have some incredibly talented African-American ambassadors and who went on to do incredible things. I mean, to hear that Ambassador Todman, six ambassadorships and, you know, all over the world, that is something to me that is just outstanding. And at the same time, a very sobering presentation that only 156 of us are in that category. It says how much work we have to do. And I know all of us are committed to doing that work to increase those numbers. To get to the question, which I think is a very, very thought-provoking question, I say that for me, there are, sitting at the head of the diplomatic table, being an African-American, I feel like I'm handling three roles at once, right? Three roles that are intertwined, three roles that are mutually reinforcing, but they're sort of like a diamond, different aspects of the same general principle. First is, I see myself as a tried and true diplomat. This is a trade craft. This is a call to public service. It is an honor to be a public servant. When I was dreaming about the Foreign Service at the age of 16, and so to 3 years later to have won the Pickering Fellowship, to then 3 years later join the Foreign Service right after graduation from grad school, it was just truly a dream come true. So I really haven't thought about another career, and this has really been something that I've just been so enamored with, and 23 years later, still very much am. So a public servant, and I am a developer, I am a promoter, and I am a defender of US policy, right? I mean, an ambassador is essentially that person who is ultimately looking at, in a particular country, looking at all aspects of our policy. And the traditional or the conventional wisdom is that Washington delivers the policy, deliberates and develops the policy, and the overseas, the ambassador and the team implements that policy. It is much more nuanced than that. I mean, the most effective ambassadors are very much at the table when it comes to developing the policy, right? And of course, they're at the head of the table when it comes to executing as well as shaping, making any course corrections. And so I think that that role is a role that you don't just sort of, that doesn't just happen. There are skills that need to be developed along the way that I think requires quite a bit of commitment and quite a bit of intentionality. What I mean by that is being very, very selective in the assignments that we take to make sure that we have a broad understanding of how policy is made. So you're spending a good amount of time in Washington, you are working in the interagency, and you're working at a variety of embassies in terms of the size, in terms of the critical issues, the core interests, so that when you're sitting at the head of the table, the issues, you may not have worked 10, 20 years in that particular issue, but you have familiarity with it. You know how to deliberate and how to develop a policy that will, with other people's input, that will be ultimately effective. So I see myself first and foremost as a diplomat. Second, I see myself as a leader. We as ambassadors are going to be very ineffective if we can't enable, motivate, guide, encourage, correct, mentor, coach people. We have to be, I think, some of the most effective ambassadors are those who can relate well to people and can draw the very best out of people. And if we're only focused on that first issue, I'm a diplomat, I am the person who is, you know, responsible for implementing the policy, I think that person will be ultimately less effective than someone who is able to mobilize an entire team and even extend that team to Washington, get all the Washington agencies involved to actually move towards a certain goal and to be able to encourage people to stay on that and to be transparent and to be inclusive and collaborative. I think these are very, very important principles to being an effective ambassador. And what comes with that as well is mentoring. I think the most effective ambassadors are thinking about the future. They're not just trying to, you know, get all the people's input to make them look good. They're actually looking outward. They are what I would call other focus versus self focus. And if an ambassador is able to not juggle as if these are two different things, you know, juggle policy and people, but actually see how they can come together, that ambassador will be much more effective. The third role is storyteller. I see myself as a storyteller. First and foremost, I have the privilege to share the American story. I also have the privilege to share the African-American story, at least from my perspective. And then I have the privilege to share my personal story. And guess what? The world is interested in all three. In all three, in every country where I have served, this is now my seventh diplomatic assignment. I can tell you the level of interest, being an American diplomat, even when I was a junior diplomat, you know, 23 years ago, I walked into a room and people turned around, probably because of my color, but also because I was the U.S. representative at that meeting. And the U.S. still has a lot of weight. And if we use that weight effectively, we can make an incredible difference. But we also have weight in terms of what I call our soft power, which is our values, our interests, and our ability to communicate with others in a way where we're able to share our experiences, not from a judging or condescending view, but as partners in the world, as allies, as friends of other countries. And so I get the privilege, I have the privilege to share the American story, but also the African-American story. And I know that Pamela can agree with me on this, that where we serve, this is now my fourth Eastern European assignment, where very much a homogenous society, right? I mean, you know, the only African-American people or African people of color who are here are normally students. You know, they are studying at some of the universities here. So I'm it, you know, when it comes to, you know, sharing the African-American experience for the most part and the countries where I've had the opportunity to work. And there is interest. You know, there is admittedly a good level of ignorance, but that's okay. My job is to reduce some of that ignorance, share with people what our experiences has been. And that actually has been quite effective to even achieving policy ends, which I can speak about later. I know there are some questions related to that in terms of some of the benefits of being an African-American a diplomat. And the third is, in terms of the storytelling, is the personal experience, right? I mean, you know, where I've grown up, you know, the fact that I've, you know, by the time I was 18, I had 12 different addresses all around the United States. Foreigners right now, Moldovans are very interested in that. I could do a Facebook Live chat just on my experience growing up in the United States and talking about how I dealt with racism in one part of the country, but then went to this melting pot in another part of the country, and how all that shaped and informed my thinking, motivated me to do what I'm doing right now. That is something that is extraordinarily attractive about effective, personable, I would even argue to say humble African-American diplomats who are at the same time very proud of who they are, where they've come from, and then drawing in their personal experiences. So That's why I believe African Americans, as was said so well by Pamela earlier, we need to be anywhere and everywhere. We shouldn't limit ourselves to one particular part of the world just because we see more African Americans in that part of the world or not. If you have a desire to go to some place where you may be the only African American in the room, and I've been in plenty of situations like that, that's okay. You are pioneering. You are opening a door. I mean, as Pamela did for me and I'm doing for others now, that can continue to be the tradition. So we have a story to tell. As an American, as an African American, and as individuals, being American as well as African American, that is important to share. So I'm looking forward to the questions, and I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Sorry about that, everyone. Thank you, Ambassador Hogan. Thank you to all three of you. I think you should know that, you know, as you're each speaking, comments that come in, you know, when you hit on such key points, it's just, I think, very, 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 very insightful. And people are suggesting that your words are insightful and encouraging, inspirational. And I think each of your journeys, from what you, a little bit that you were able to describe there of your journeys, help those who are in the diplomatic corps, those who are not. So, you know, I think we really appreciate that. Before I read a few of these questions, I think it's also just important because all of you touched on it in one way or another. I think the term or the word mentor is often, you know, sometimes maybe it's overused, but I think it comes up over and over again as I look at the history of Black American U.S. ambassadors, and every single one has either been mentored or is actively engaging in mentoring of others. You know, not just being mentored by only Blacks or mentoring only Black Americans, but being mentored by a variety of sources. And I think it's important to note that, again, if we're talking about a small number of 156 in history, Black American U.S. ambassadors, that's a small number, but there's been such a huge, huge reach, I guess, I'd say, between and by, there's a huge web of interconnectivity, I guess I should say, among those 156 and the people who they've touched. So I think that's very important, and that they've been touched by. I think that's a very important thing. So let me go through some of these questions. And one, I'm not sure who exactly to put this to. I may put it to Ambassador Spratlin or Ambassador Hogan as Foreign Service officers, so working within the State Department. The question may also be for me, I might be able to touch on it, but the question is, can you please talk about who the external stakeholders or organizations are that track diversity related data at state and provide their own independent analysis people in the suggestion was besides GAO and OIG and EEOC. I think we know that they track some of this, but do you all know anything about where data and the diversity within the State Department is tracked and discussed outside of the government offices? So again, I put that to Ambassador Spratlin or Ambassador Hogan, if either of you have any thoughts on that.
Yes, I would be happy to, I'd be happy just to speak to it a little bit. All of the organizations, please don't rush by those, because the General Accounting Office put out a report last summer, but it had a lot of detail about what had happened in both the civil service and the foreign service with respect to numbers. And so anybody looking for a sort of official count, I think that report is a great reference point. It is the Director General who looks at this issue in the human resources part of the State Department. To try to track all kinds of data about what is happening. The challenge is how much of that is public. And that's why the reports like the GAO report are so important, because anybody can go onto an internet browser and look at that. And then programs like the Pickering program. And I'm just absolutely thrilled. We also shouldn't rush past the fact that Ambassador Hogan is the first Pickering Fellow. I had the great privilege of serving as an evaluator of the applications of the Pickering program this past October. And what a fabulous experience it was to see what is happening with the young people who want to be in the international affairs arena, not just in the Foreign Service, although the Pickering program is of course interested in having people come into the Foreign Service, but some of those people will go do other things as well. And I think it's extremely important that we have programs like that. So the folks who are running that program who are associated with Howard University may also have some data. And you know, Dr. McLellan, you may have some ideas about where some of that data is might be housed. Before I give the floor back though, I wanted to say a word just to pick up on Ambassador Hogan's excellent remarks. And I really appreciate everything he said about my role, whatever small role I played, I'm certainly grateful for that. And we all need to keep trying to interest more and more people in the State Department. But just on this very program, you have some amazing people on in the audience. We have Ambassador Brazil, one of the Ambassador Aurelia Brazil, one of the early ambassadors who served in three different posts as the US ambassador. And I have had the chance to sit down and talk with her. She's just a fascinating person who knows the Foreign Service from when it was extremely difficult. It's always challenging. It always brings its challenges. And I think Ambassador Brigety talked about that very, very well. But I think it was even more difficult at that time. And she obviously did a brilliant job because she was selected three times. But also Sylvia Stansfield, who is the president of the American Black Ambassadors Association, is on with us today. Harriet Elam Thomas, who was a public diplomacy officer and served in Senegal as the ambassador, and Maddie Sharpless, Ambassador Maddie Sharpless, who served in the Central African Republic, and I think is representative of the fact that it's not just the State Department representatives. While we are the vast majority of the career professionals who become ambassadors in that small group of 156, there are some people from other agencies who have the opportunity to do that as well. And Ambassador Sharpless is one of those people, and who she's done a tremendous job. I mention all of these people because of what Ambassador Hogan said about mentoring. All of these people have been, and so many more, have been excellent mentors to me and to so many other people. We cannot, Ambassador Brigety used this term political capital. It's a wonderful term because it does talk about what you have to gather. It takes time to gather that. And how do you do that? Mentors help you figure out what your talents are. They help you see things in yourself that you can't even know are there. And so mentoring is extremely important, both the people who select you and the people you select as mentors. And so I just wanted to give a shout out to all of those people who've done so much, who happen to be on this, Zoom today, so many others who are not. But the idea of mentoring, it makes the journey of gathering that political capital a little bit more possible. The last thing I want to say is, as important as it is to be ambassador, please remember that there are other roles in the State Department that are also fabulous. The question that I'm probably most asked about is not my ambassadorships, but the fact that I was principal officer, I was the consul general in Vladivostok, Russia. And, you know, that's a, you know, game of risk, far away. It was a fascinating assignment. The consul general has its own special categories, special unique features, and the kind of leadership that's necessary to be an ambassador. It's one of the places where you can gather some of that experience. So I just wanted to say that, but also just back to your original question about data, there are a few places where it's gathered, but not nearly enough, because the information that you shared with us, I learned some things that are new to me. So please tell us whatever else you know about where we can get statistics, Dr. McLellan. I think we all need to know. Thank you, over to you.
Thank you, Ambassador Spratley. Apologies for that, it takes a moment for me to get unmuted, so sorry about that. Ambassador Hogan, I don't know if you had anything to add to that in terms of where you know of this kind of data on diversity, about diversity at the State Department may come. If so, I offer you opportunity to do that. If not,
No. I think Ambassador Spratland answered that question very well, and I know we've got so many others. So I'm ready to, you know. Oh, sorry, Ambassador Brigger, you got something too. I'll stop. I'll get.
Ambassador Brigety, you wanted to add something to that one?
There you go. Now it's unmuted. Thanks very much. So I wrote an article about this in Foreign Affairs in 2016, foreignaffairs.com, which I'll see if I can get it and put it in the chat function. And it takes on what I think Ambassador Fratlin so articulately addressed, was the issue of mentorship. And I also add another concept. Mentorship is vital. So is sponsorship. And the difference between a mentor and a sponsor is a mentor is somebody who obviously will help you grow, help you to see part of yourselves, will coach you along. A sponsor is somebody who is able and willing to pick up the phone and make a call to say, you know, Carlton needs to be your one of one for this assignment. And the best is when you have the same person. It's both. When your mentors can become your sponsors, but it's not always the case. And so one of the reasons that distinction is important is because when you take a look at the demographics at the senior levels across the entire foreign policy and national security establishment, two things are true. One, objectively true. One, there is no place across the entire foreign policy establishment in the United States of America, foreign service, intelligence agencies, officer ranks of the US military, where the level of diversity at senior ranks is anything close to the level of diversity at the point of accession. Which means that women and ethnic minorities attrite at a higher rate than white men do. And unless you believe that women and ethnic minorities are simply not as good as white men, something else is happening, right? That's the empirical data, right? I'm not making that up. The second implication of that is that if you're going to change that calculus, white men have to do a better job at being sponsors for everybody else. That is also just sort of a logical consequence of that empirical data. Which gets to finally to a point that Dr. McLellan said at the outset. I have been blessed, as I'm sure many others here can say, I've been blessed to have some fantastic mentors. My mentors have been African-American and non-African-American. They have been men and they have been women. And at key junctures in my career, the people who also turned out to be sponsors were not only, and Frank, probably not even principally African-Americans, simply because of the relative dearth of them in positions to be able to pick up the phone and make that call. So it's important, I think, for individually and for all of us to do sort of two things. The first is to continue to develop and cultivate your mentorship network on the hope that they will either become sponsors themselves or they can pick up the phone and call somebody who could be a sponsor. And the second is we have to continue to talk about this issue. So we can enlist more non-people of color, principally white men, as allies who prepare to be sponsors to make sure that America is living up to its promise of true equality in this space. Thanks.
Thank you. Appreciate that, sir. I'm going to pose this next question. I believe I'll pose it to Ambassador Hogan. Although, of course, once he shares his thoughts, Ambassador Spratlin, Ambassador Brigety, you're most welcome to project as well. The question is this, how does one who has had years of field experience as a diplomat in the embassy community make the transition to the Washington table, i.e. a connection, getting your name out there, any tips would be welcome. So that's the question, Ambassador Hogan.
Okay, thanks. Good question. Two things. One is, I think it needs to be, not it needs to be, the way I did it was to make it sort of even. I did two tours overseas and then went back to Washington, did a couple of tours in Washington, went back out and then went back in. And so it wasn't a huge jump for me to go to Washington, because I'd already had a number of contacts and my experience in Washington was established pretty much as a mid-level officer. And so that's one is a, consider just going back and forth, you know, having a two or three tours out, a one or two tours in. Certainly, you know, personally speaking, financially, Washington can be a little bit expensive for those, you know, folks who are at the probably less than 01 level or the, you know, GS-15 equivalent. So it's a sacrifice when you go back to Washington in some ways, but I think it's worth it. I think we are much better. We are much more adept diplomats if we have a clear understanding of the Washington interagency, of the paper process, of the personalities, who's really driving the trains, all those sorts of things I think are critical. They're also critical to getting good onward assignments overseas, going into the office and talking to the people who are making those decisions. So I think just sort of a more even flow between overseas and Washington is helpful to making that jump, because it won't really be that big of a jump. The second thing is to consider different types of jobs in Washington. So for me, I wanted to have global perspective going back to Washington. So for example, I would go to the seventh floor with sort of the senior State Department level, where the secretary and the undersecretaries and deputy secretaries sit, and work in positions that gave me a global perspective. So our operations center, which is our 24/7 crisis center, gave me a vantage point in terms of what's happening in the entire world. And that was really, really useful. That actually led me to a position where I worked in the Secretary Colin Powell's private office for a year. And so again, that global perspective, I think, really made me, I think, a better diplomat, and that I wasn't just focused on what was happening in Eastern Europe. I was able to draw on my experiences in other parts of the world and in policy areas around the world that helped me get a better fix on some of the things we can do, let's say, in Eastern Europe. So consider those sorts of jobs in Washington, especially if you are sort of a more of a person who would like to spend more time overseas versus in Washington. Think about the types of job that will give you the biggest bang for the buck. And another way of saying it, and there are those sorts of jobs that allow you to get a lot of interaction with senior policymakers that will give you that global perspective. And if you're trying to figure out, let's say, you want to do a couple of parts of the world, you want to do, let's say, Africa and Latin America, going back to Washington, it helps you make that bridge, you know, because you can do a job in a bureau that you want to go to as an overseas assignment. So that's also, I think, Washington being part of your career, sort of like yeast that sort of, you know, that's kneaded into that bread. It's not something that's like a once and a done thing. It's part of your upbringing, if you will, just makes you much more effective, I think, as a diplomat and ambassador, ultimately.
Thank you, sir. Ambassador Spratlin, Ambassador Brigety, do you want to add something to that? If not, I'll move to the next question.
I would like to add just a couple of points. Please. I think Ambassador Hogan did an excellent job of talking about why coming back to Washington is important, the pattern of assignments and so on. But I want to step back from the sort of careerist focus and also just ask everyone in the audience to just reflect. Why is it that you're interested in this career? Because I remember being on a promotion panel one time, and I had wonderful people that I served with. And one was a consular officer, African-American consular officer, who had never served in Washington. And he made his decision that he was in the Foreign Service to serve and support people and to see the world. And he could do that by serving overseas. And so he made the decision to do that. He may have sacrificed a little bit in rank, but at the end of his career, and he was nearing the end of his career and getting ready to retire, he was satisfied with what he had done. So I think as important as it is to think about the sort of the game of the Foreign Service, and it is a little bit that, but there's also just what is going to bring you personal satisfaction And if the idea of running around clearing paper or sitting in meetings is just utterly anathema to you, then you might not want to make that part of what you're going to do in your career, but understand that policy is made in Washington. The State Department exists to help to create our foreign policy and then to be the ones to implement it. And so if you want that to be a part of your career, then you absolutely need to come back to Washington, because the policy is made here in Washington. This is the mothership. You need to learn to write. You need to learn how the paper, how to deal with getting your issues put forward and how to make your case. You need to learn how to do the briefings. You need to learn to work in the interagency process and how to get on with your colleagues. And back to Ambassador Brigety's point about sponsors. Many of them are here in Washington, the people who can pick up those phones. So you will get to know a vast array of people, depending on where you are, if you are serving in Washington. So having that balance between the two is important, but building your expertise as a Foreign Service officer, it's important to come back to Washington if you want to be part of the policy staff. Over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Spratlin. Let's go to another question here. It's sort of a combination of several questions, I think, that have been asked, and it's related to issue of just diversity and inclusion in general. There's been several, I don't know if some of you may know, there's been several recent articles from the Council on Foreign Relations, from Mother Jones publications about the new administration's thought process on including, you know, the diversity within our foreign policy establishment as part of its priority. And so just on this whole issue of equity and diversity and inclusion, and this is to the three of you in general, I think it's, how have you found yourselves, or how did you find yourselves, if you're an ambassador in the past, navigating these topics with your international counterparts? And again, especially in the last year, but navigating questions around diversity and inclusion and equity with your international counterparts, how have you navigated that conversation, if that question makes sense? I'll just pose it. Let's start with Ambassador Hogan, since he's currently serving, if he doesn't mind talking a bit about that.
Sure. I saw Ambassador Brigety's hand, so I'm a little bit, but I'll start. I'll make it quick. I'll just say that it is something that I don't shy away from. What we have endured in the United States, particularly over this past year, is something that we need to be able to talk about. And I do it in a way that says, yep, this is what you see. This is a society that is still working out some very, very deep-seated issues that we really haven't gotten through. And what you hope, and what I was telling people, of course, while this was all playing out, is what I hope to see as an American citizen is that those who broke the law will be held accountable, and that the system will work out, and that there will be people who will be demanding that, and they have the right to demand that in the United States. And so you see a very robust, intense, vibrant, unfortunately sometimes violent, but very much serious debate in the United States about how we overcome these challenges that we've been dealing with for hundreds of years. And I think, you know, particularly in the parts of the world where I'm working, where democracy is still very much an elusive goal, that, you know, they don't have it yet. This is something that they can relate to. And I, as an African-American, have a unique perspective on that, because I'm not shying away from it. I'm saying it was utterly wrong to see what happened to George Floyd. And I'll talk about that. And I'll talk about, you know, January 6th, what happened at the Capitol. I mean, these are things that I think make us as American diplomats, as American ambassadors, I think more authentic. You know, because I'm not telling these folks here in Moldova, for example, that I've got all the answers and that all you need to do is follow this prescription and that all will go well. what I'm saying is I'm sharing our experience as a society that you can see it's on the front pages. And look, by the way, you can actually see it on the front pages. It's not being covered up like what's happened in, you know, and some countries where I've worked. That you can see that we're still working through this stuff. And so we encourage you, Moldova, whatever country else, to keep working on these issues. You're not going to be able to just to sweep this under the rug. It will keep festering. So I use it as part of my policy engagement to address some of the more fundamental issues that are holding these countries back from, you know, true prosperity, from true growth in every way.
Ambassador Brigety? Can we unmute Ambassador Brigety?
There you go. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
I'd say a couple things. First of all, I have been in direct and continuous conversation with the Biden administration with regard to diversifying their foreign affairs agencies. I know that they take this charge extremely seriously. But diversity across the board, certainly in terms of African-Americans, but also in terms of other people of color, LGBT issues, et cetera. And so I am 1,000% confident that this is a priority for them in a way that, quite frankly, it was an anti-priority for the previous administration. And this is something that ought not be a partisan issue. It ought to be across the board, and hopefully, and let's remember, the first two African American secretaries of state and the first two African American national security advisors were appointed by Republican presidents. And so this ought to be a bipartisan issue, and hopefully will continue to be so. Secondly, with regard to how do you talk about these sorts of things, in addition to what Ambassador Hogan said, it's some ways harder to talk about them at home than it is abroad, for all of the reasons that as Americans we know so well. And where I start from having these conversations is I'm relentless on two points. I'm relentless about the values that we all ought to share, and I'm relentless about the empirical record. Because we have to be able to continue to ask the question, how does the record stack up against our values? If there's a gap, why are we tolerating it? And what are we going to do about it? Let me also just kind of offer one other thing. I know we have people here of all ages, but I think that what I'm about to say will help offer some clarity. You know, a friend of mine, Travis Atkins, who I hope is known to many of you, said something to me a few years ago, and it struck me like a thunderbolt. Travis and I were born in the same year, 1973. And he said, you know, being born in 1973, we belong to the very first generation of African-Americans since Black people first landed on American shores in 1619, that were born fully free and equal under the law to all of our fellow citizens. Even people who were born a few years earlier in the late 1960s cannot say the same thing, given laws that were still on the books and Supreme Court decisions that are yet to be resolved. And so from my view, what is fundamentally different that is happening right now than all the previous times we have had these sorts of reckonings is that what is happening right now is that we are finally at long last having a conversation amongst equals. As somebody who is now firmly ensconced in middle age with my trifocal glasses and my bow ties and my orthopedic shoes, and therefore has achieved enough in my life where I'm not only sort of confident about what I've done, but confident about who I am. And we have a generation of younger people in their 20s now and 30s who have, thank God, have no lived experience with the law officially treating them as second-class citizens. We are now at a point where people are asking, why do we have to continue to have this gap between what our values tell us we ought to be as Americans and what has been the historical record and what is still the lived experience of too many people of color? The good news is that there are more and more people now across the demographic and ideological spectrum who are like, yeah, that's right. That's right. We, George Floyd, opened our eyes in a way in which, quite frankly, many of us just didn't see. So let us continue to take that conversation to its logical conclusion so that we can be the America that we profess to be on paper. Thanks.
Sorry, it takes a second to unmute. Ambassador Spratlin, did you have anything you wanted to add to that before I move on? Welcome to.
Yes, I would like to say just a few things. I would love to have a conversation with Ambassador Brigety, because I'm not sure I agree with him about all the things he said. But certainly I agree that in the last year, since the murder of George Floyd, I would say there's been a change. And I actually want to go back to a photo, and I'm sure we all remember last year when the ambassador, a political appointee, military officer in Seoul, put a Black Lives Matter banner, an absolutely huge one, on the embassy, and the picture was there of the American flag and the Black Lives Matter banner. And then we're talking about South Korea. And this, you know, sparked a debate, but really it was just that visual for me. How do you talk about these kinds of issues with a foreign government? Well, sometimes it's not words. Sometimes it's the symbols that you use about something being very important. And to have an ambassador, even for one day, I think it very quickly had to come down. The Secretary of State made it very clear that, you know, the embassy had to be focused on having the American flag and focused on what we were doing in the bilateral relationship with South Korea. But just for that one moment, I think it was important for that focus to be there on Black Lives Matter and saying something about what was happening in the United States at a very important, sensitive moment in our history, and sharing that with people with whom he serves there as the US ambassador. I think that was very, very meaningful. So I just wanted to make the point that sometimes it's not words. Sometimes we communicate in symbols, and those images can be very, very powerful. I only wanted to say that there's also the issue of gender, and I have served in places where both the values that Ambassador Hogan spoke of and the issues of both race and gender can come up. In the area of gender, because I've served in several countries that are at least nominally not they're Muslim societies, but that has a very unique and special definition, I think, in certain countries, but are very patriarchal. And I was concerned about this when I first being considered for going to Uzbekistan, at that time very much a closed country. And so I asked my predecessor to speak with a senior official in the government about what I could expect. And the senior official said, well, please tell Ambassador Spratlin, she doesn't have to worry. We are, you know, very open, very friendly here, and we're going to receive her very warmly. And I would say for the most part, that was true. But there were some times when the issue of my being a woman did come into conflict for the host government with some of their policies. And it took us a while to work things out. We ultimately did. But sometimes these conversations are very, very tough ones, because we are talking about values that are not always the same. But the one thing I think that people all over the world can expect, and I thank President Carter for this and other presidents who've made values and democracy and human rights the center of what, or have certainly made it important in our foreign policy. For this, is that people can expect that U.S. ambassadors will raise issues of values. There are going to be different issues. Sometimes it's going to be LGBT. Sometimes it's going to be labor issues. Sometimes it's going to be democracy, so the free press. But these issues of values will be raised by Americans. And I think, and as Ambassador Hogan said, it will happen in a public forum, because anybody can go online and look at what's happening in the United States. And I think that's a very powerful part of what we're able to bring as a country to the whole world of international affairs. What's going on in Myanmar? What's going on in certain parts of Africa? Everybody is able to look at this, but also think about it in the context of what the United States would say. And now that, as Ambassador Thomas Greenfield has said, we are back, they can expect that these issues will be raised. And so these conversations will go on. And when I think there's an ambassador who represents a group that hasn't traditionally been part of the ambassadorial corps, I think that conversation is even richer because of what that person can bring. Everybody can have that conversation, and many, many do, and it's good. But I think there's a unique offering that we can make as African-Americans to that dialogue, not only at home, but also with our interlocutors in the countries where we serve. Over to you.
Thank you all. I believe we only have about 10 minutes left. We're gonna try and get to a few more of these questions. Very great questions. And I think this next one actually kind of touches on some of what was just said, and particularly Ambassador Spratlin's mentioning of symbols and images and how powerful they are, that sort of thing. But one person asked, and this is for the three of you, during the inauguration, President Biden states this powerful statement: "We will lead not merely by the example of our power, but by the power of our example." And so the question really is just, how do you translate that sentiment, that sort of sentiment that he said, how do you translate that into relations within your embassy, as well as the host government in the country that you're in? So that's the question that I'll pose. Let's start with Ambassador Hogan, please, if you don't mind.
Yeah, that is a great question. I'll start with the internal first, the organizational culture. That to me is critical because, again, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, the extent to which the team that I am leading is on the same page, shares the vision, is charged up by the vision, I think the more effective we as a team are going to be. And so organizational culture is very important to me. And so, you know, I mean, I went into a mission where at the time, 2.5 years ago, I was one of two African-Americans, and maybe there was one or two more persons of color in the mission of about 300 or so people. And I said to that mission, even though there wasn't a lot of diversity there, if you will, at least when it comes to race and nationality, I said, you know, we are going to be an embassy that attracts diversity. This is going to be something that is going to be a critical value for us. So we're going to work towards that when it comes to recruiting for diverse candidates. You know, we're going to get ourselves out there. We're going to create videos to say, hey, you know, bid on Moldova. This is a place where all of you, no matter where you come from, no matter what your walk of life is, you have a place here. You have a home here. So that's part of a larger organizational culture change that we tried to do here. But I think that's important that they saw from the very first day, you know, my very first day at work, this was part of my value statement. That we are people that are going to respect each other, and we also are going to do our best to make this embassy look a little bit more like what America truly is. And so we have a country team that is charged up with that. They are on the hunt for diverse candidates, and I think are doing an excellent job in that respect. On the out, in terms of the external, I won't really repeat what I said before, because again, I think I used the example of what's happening in our country, was certainly what happened last year, as an example of how even developed countries such as ours are still struggling with some very fundamental issues, and I use that to encourage countries that are only have 28 years of independence, you know, that haven't had a democratic transition yet, for example, that they can say, wait a minute, United States. Well, they're struggling and they've got, you know, 240 something years of independence and they're still struggling with some very basic issues. Okay, we can work on this, but we have to be at least on the same trajectory. We have to get to the same trajectory. So as I constantly bring in what's happened in the United States. I constantly, and I use as an example, my own personal experience with racism growing up in the United States. Because again, I want people to know that this is something that you, that I, as an American, it's part of my story. It's not a very pleasant part of my story, but it's what's made me who I am. And I am here to help you overcome the very dark moments in your history as well. So I use this part of my storytelling, as I said at the beginning. I'll stop there.
Ambassador Brigety, or Ambassador, do you have anything you'd like to add, please?
Yeah, briefly, as I know we're almost out of time, I would say two things. First of all, you have to have the conversation, and you can't be afraid to do it, and it should be in a structured format. And if anybody asks why, you can tell them because Linda Thomas Greenfield did the same thing. I'm going to put in the chat right now a talk that she did when she was assistant secretary that I helped her moderate for the Africa Bureau that is on the State Department website, conversation about race. And we have to have the courage to have these conversations and have multiple viewpoints to be able to sort of say them. So that was the first thing I would say. The second is I'm going to shamelessly plug an article that I have out in the current issue of Foreign Affairs titled The Fractured Power, How to Overcome Tribalism. And it makes the argument that the United States is exhibiting many of the signs of tribalism, tribalism as defined as countries, whether they be more or less developed, that are riven by sectarian divisions along race or racial lines that make it very hard to be able to to solve common problems, communal problems through reasoned debate. And we are increasingly defined by that in our own country. And we have to apply those tools that we would apply elsewhere to ourselves. And amongst them are the importance of leadership, as well as the importance of local action, micro action as it were, for people to reach beyond their tribal lines. And so particularly on that latter point, every single one of us here as professionals, as citizens, as networks that touch beyond our own communities have a role to play in that regard. And I would encourage you all to take up that mantle. I'll put the link to the article in the chat. Thanks.
Ambassador Spratlin, would you like to add anything to that?
Sure, I'll just say something very brief because I know we're almost out of time. Yeah. And since you started with the president and a quote that he gave at the inauguration, I'll just leave everybody with an image again because I think it's so important. Because I just want to say that, you know, the United States has many challenges and all of us have talked about those. This issue of diversity is in international affairs is certainly one. What happened over the last few years in terms of our governance and certainly what happened on the 6th of January at the Capitol, we have to continue to really reflect on that, what that means about our country and all of the discussions that we've had. At the same time, there is the inaugural itself, in which I think the president spoke exactly, and we all got to see exactly what he meant by the power of our example, because it was in the very same space and it showed what America at its best really is. And I think we as ambassadors, when we go abroad, that's what we try to represent, America at its best. So I'm just gonna leave it at that. It's a great honor.
Thank you. Well, it looks like, wow, that was a very fast hour and a half that has blown by. And I think it speaks to the level of engagement, knowledge that our distinguished guests have brought to the table. So on behalf of BPIA and all the other program sponsors, if you will, I just really wanted to thank each of you for taking the time out of your busy days, your busy schedules, to share with the listeners. I think everyone will agree that we learned a great deal. It's so important that we hear directly from our leadership. And again, as I said earlier, this is really an underutilized, underrepresented, under-researched, under everything area of American leadership, not just Black leadership. But I think we spend a lot of time looking at CEOs and other so-called leaders, but we don't hammer down into our ambassadors and what you all have done and are doing in your respective leadership roles. And I think it's very important that people take an interest in that and study your story. So we thank you so much, each of you, for joining us today. If you have any other questions for any of them, maybe we can get them to them in some other way. I think BPIA outreach at iabpia.org, which I think is in the chat box, is you can send further follow-up or questions directly there. But again, just wanted to repeat, thank the three of you very much. We hope you'll enjoy the rest of your days and your evening there Ambassador Hogan, and we hope you enjoyed being with us as much as we enjoyed having you. So with that, we will sign off and look for the next one. Maybe we'll continue this conversation in another time. Thank the three of you very much. Cheers.